Chicago.
You're going where?
Going back home.
You're going back north, you're going Chicago.
There we go, I'm working now.
Okay. So I'd like to introduce Rajesh Choksi, Glenbard North, Peter Delamater of West Chicago, and they're going to talk about their project that they've called MAGV.
I see that MAGV is the camera project.
It means that it's a magnetic connector for the USB type B, which are used in Android phones.
All right, we started basing off the statement, I really hate it when I trip over my charging cable, or I guess for that measure, pull or yank on anyway, and damage my device. Our problem statement, which we didn't get around to condensing, basically says there are loose cables for various reasons all over home and work environments, and they do cause tripping injuries.
Yeah, they cause tripping hazards, fire hazards, etc.
And they also, when they're tripped over, they will break down and need to be take time material and light to be replaced.
So we did research on this OSHA website, it's the Occupational Safety and Health Association, and it stated that approximately 19,565 people are injured or die from workplaces in the U.S. just alone because of loose cables. So they either trip or something like that, trip fire hazards from loose cables.
We also learned that accidental trips and falls account for 15% of accidental deaths.
And also 39% of all falls being damaged is because of their job on hard surfaces. So we did that. We did magnets to solve that problem because if you yank the cable, the phone's going to yank too, so it got damaged.
Sorry, this is kind of freaking me out lately. The remotes.
Is it a battery issue?
No, the battery was just replaced before we came in here.
Okay.
All right, so we did look at previous...
Excuse us a minute.
It's a useful tool, but it's only designed to charge specific MacBook laptops, which is very, very specific.
And its function is similar to what we had. Whenever something is pulled or if the force is heavier, then these are all magnets that connect and they destroy it. So it drops without harm enough. We're damaging the $1,500 MacBook.
Alright, our solution concept was to create a charger that will disconnect your phone. Sorry, a charger that will connect to the phone and then disconnect itself when the cord is yanked or pulled before the phone is damaged. Besides these basic requirements, we also want our project to have a long lifespan, so you're not going and buying a new one every 6 months because who likes that. We also want it to connect easily. So it's no more of a hassle than your current charger. We want it to connect in more than one position, which is, I guess, with the extension of connect easily, you don't have to align things specifically before they're connected.
Yeah, you can orient it in any way, or so you don't have to waste time doing it. You can just quickly make it put it in that diagram.
Also, we want it to be an adapter rather than an entire cable. So when it's produced, it's easier to produce a small adapter and that same adapter and the charging cable. We ended up using magnets for our final prototype, but we also experimented with using a ball bearing idea. decided to go against it because ball bearings, the way they work, they are little mechanical balls that, little metal balls that would go in and out of sockets and are held in by a pin. So it hold things in very well. However, it's a mechanical part, and the mechanical parts get worn down over time of use.
Yes, and because of the shape, it's like a circular or semi-circular, and most ones have a rectangular opening for a charging cable. So you would have to make another adapter to fit this in, which is not effective.
All right, here's the priority table. This is where one place where we decided to go with our geomagnetic instead of ball bearings. Priority tables are used to sort out what your priorities are and how your various solution ideas compare with those priorities. Here's a screenshot of our first design. You can see with these little metal squares, this was one of our earlier ideas on how to get it to connect in multiple orientations. Because these are all squares, no matter what 90 degree offset you connect it on, it will snap together and charge perfectly. But we end up scrapping this idea because creating these squares out of metal turned out to be harder than we anticipated, and they would only work when put in a very specific alignment.
And we couldn't find any parts on any of the online digital websites.
This shows a couple of the refinements we built over time. This is one of our earliest prototypes. We still were attempting to build an entire charging cable instead of a simple adapter. And you can see it also has the same design here. The later prototype here, this is when we redesigned it. It no longer has a cable out the back, but it still is, we're still not using spring pins, which is what we decided later. We're still trying to make it work with these metallic squares.
So this is like one of the failed attempts that we did in AutoCAD 3D here. As you can see in the picture, there's like many different shapes and sizes and different things because they all function differently. Your 3D printer are not that useful, like they are, but the measurements are
not perfect.
So sometimes the sizes are different, the whole sizes, like as you can see here, that's with their magnets. So we experimented with different types and then we figured out one, right here, it's supposed to be like a trapezoid. So whenever you connect in any size, it won't work. So it would only work in one way. So if you plug it in two ways, it won't work. It won't connect magnetically.
Alright. One of the tests we did was to see how much force it actually takes to slide a phone across a table. Because if we find how much force it takes, and then we have our magnets greater than that force, the magnets will have a strong enough pull to slide the phone across the table when the cord is pulled. That if we had it stronger than this average number we decided on here, our charger would be completely ineffective. In the creation of our final prototype, we use the aforementioned 3D printed shells, spring pins and receptacles, and we're supposed to have an image over here, but something went wrong at that point, so that would have shown what all of these parts looked like.
Yeah, compared to your hands, they're really small, so that's one of the difficulties we had working with.
So we also used standard USB connectors and sockets, small little magnets that would hold everything together. And we ordered everything, all these in bulk. When we divided up the cost, we found it came around to $5. Hmm. This is the final prototype. You probably can't see it too well, but these are the spring pin, we were supposed to have a picture showing exactly what those did, but it said it disappeared. These are a couple images of the final prototype. It's also missing a desk over there. We weren't able to attach the USB sockets because the solder points on those things were absolutely tiny, and we weren't able to do it. We asked the teacher for help. He wasn't able to solder the things. They are not meant to solder by hand well. All right. also decided that Project Vasa is a little ambitious, mostly because neither of us are any sort of expert in electrical parts. So to build an entire project based around electrical parts probably was the best idea, really. If we had more time to develop our product, we would have found the expertise to correctly solder our connectors. We would be able to work with companies to create circuit boards to mount all these parts on, which would be far simpler solution. And we'd also find spring pins with a weaker spring force, because we got to mention later. One problem with our final prototype is the force of the pins was greater than the force of the magnets. So the result is a split between the two sides, because these pins are forcing it apart.
Mm-hmm. Make you uncomfortable for a long time, but let me just process for a second.
Okay.
I guess we'll.
Okay.
Are you relieved that it's over?
A little, yeah.
Okay. When did you get started? I mean, when did your design idea start? Is this the first idea you had when you wanted to solve this problem? Not the design. I know you went through another couple of steps. Is this the problem you wanted to solve January 25th.
It's as part of one of the assignments, we all listed out a lot of solutions and then narrowed it down from there, and this was the final one.
Okay.
So this is not the only idea we had.
Okay. What else were you considering?
It's been a while.
We're doing an alarm that would shut off like when you're cooking. You shut off so you don't smoke like you're cooking something and
yeah.
How it never happens when you use a microwave, I'm telling you.
Yeah.
I cook everything in a microwave, no problem.
We decided against that one because that would require even more electronics. That would require not only electronic parts, electronic circuits. And
So here are my thoughts. One, I am impressed by the ambition. And you pointed out that that is something that, you know, on reflection, I appreciate the ambition to try something. And I appreciate the reflection. I'm going, you know what? Now that we've got through the project, it's a little bit, some deep thoughts, and we did our best with it. As I wrote some, I think your priority, can you go back to your priority table? Found that to be interesting, okay? Now, if we're trying to solve the damage to phones and the potential for tripping, talk to me a little bit about how you came up with your ratings for doing nothing, ball bearing, and magnetic constant.
These are mostly logical deductions, I guess you could say, for a better use of the words. These are less supported by actual direct research we did, and more what we thought it over, we figured the consequences of each idea, each design.
Can you also then show me your early design concepts? Yeah. Explain to me again a reason for using the square concept. Walk me back through the 30 seconds on this one. I just need to know, I want your rationale on that.
Okay, the reasoning was these squares, this would be when we researched it, USB cords had four cables, four connections that had to run through.
So one of them is power positive, power negative, then ground wire, and then data.
So the idea was each of these rings would have a different one of those wires attached. Because the other side of it had, you can't see it from this angle, but the other side had matching rings on the inside. So if you have a square as connected here, if you rotate it, it'll still connect.
There you go. Okay.
If that.
So
makes
rather
sense.
Than having a rectangle where it would only work two of four ways.
Yeah.
So you could have taken Pentagon and had the same idea, because the Pentagon would allow you to have.
Got yeah, we
got, okay. That help.
You know, we decided on a square because we figured creating these in squares would be easier than all sorts of weird designs.
And not a circle because.
I don't remember why not a circle, honestly.
Okay. You know, your past other solutions, things that you found on the market, you haven't seen anything like this on the market?
We've seen a couple things that use the concept of detaching cables easily, but nothing that uses standard equipment like USB ports. Like you mentioned with the MagSafe, there's a couple other things, but they were always very, very specific products for a very specific brand.
A specific device rather than...
Yeah.
This would be connected with a USB in here, as you imagine it?
Yes.
And that's about the size of the device in your hand?
No, we later had to enlarge our design to fit all the parts in.
Okay. But that looks like it has a USB port on that side.
Yeah.
Something that would approximate that size.
Yeah, the original photo, actually it's on the poster board behind you. We had to turn up the brightness to actually get it to, before we turned up the brightness, you couldn't actually see what was on here, and that kind of ruined the graphics on this. You can no longer tell exactly what that is, because it's a white blob.
Guys, other comments, other thoughts?
If I may, you're not just a viewer. And not a greedy. So I have a question. While you guys were building this and you were working on a project separately, we talked a little bit, so I have a question. With the USB cord running through this magnetic thing, I was thinking this idea while you guys were discussing. Thank you. Don't you make it so that the USB cord and the box all fit into one? And somehow shrink the size of the magnetic box instead of it having to be this large thing into something smaller, like maybe the size of like a mint or something.
All the parts could be shrunk down farther than they are, but at that point it would be, every time we shrink it down, it's increasingly difficult for us to create this thing.
Yeah, and then that's my second, that leads into my second question. If you were to mass produce this, how would you do it with, besides with 3D printers?
Probably like contact a company that does like circuit boards and they can manufacture this.
So then you would be putting more, so your estimated cost would be $5 per product, right?
Yes, that would increase that.
$5 material cost.
Yes.
Yeah.
But not for production cost. Because
right.
You're hitting a big, manufacturing the product, you have material cost, you have time, expertise, and so those all factor in. What's your unit price? What would you estimate market? If you were going to try to sell this bagger, how long does it take a guy at $24 an hour for a line of employees to just guesstimate? What would you think?
I'd say around. I have no experience or expertise at all with that sort of thing. So
about
$10.
$5 material cost. Okay.
Because
not a fair question.
Yeah.
Like when I look online, like to buy chargers for like my phone or like other devices, I see them like running up more like $11-$12, like something that will actually work, not like these knockoff frames, if you will, that will break or mess up your phone within a matter of weeks, I would say. So that was my question, like. What would a reasonable estimate cost be just for like the whole product when you purchase it?
Yeah,
it's
like the unit price like $10 to $12.
Right. I'm good on my part.
Is this what I guess I'm kind of trying to understand what this is. Is this something I would buy in addition to my cord though?
Yes.
This would be something that I could attach to all of my devices. So if I had, depending on what I was, I have, I understand what you're trying to do, because I have Max at home, and I love those cords, because you knock into it, and it doesn't rip your, you know, it doesn't bend the pins inside, and it doesn't, you know, rip your computer off the table, or, so this is like an adapter that I could attach to all my cords.
Our, the design we're going for here, is designed for the USB port types that Android uses primarily. Type B, but it could be easily redesigned to work with iPhones or standard USB or a variety of other things.
So then, so piggybacking off of our idea, why couldn't you guys just make one magnetic lock that could fit all of them devices, so then you don't have to like worry about getting like the wrong magnetic
It would, I'm thinking it would attach to the other end. Instead of the part that attaches to here, I'm envisioning this as the other part of the cord.
Oh, you are?
The cube.
Oh, the cube. Okay.
That way, the USB, so on the other side of whatever this adapter would be, the wall plug.
Okay, I'll
and then it would, well, because how could you make it? How could you make it what you're saying?
Well,
a universal, how could it be a universal adapter if the inside is, you know, because that's different for everybody. But,
yeah.
But the USB part is always the USB part. So if it was the wall plug, the plug adapter.
Yeah. All right, I was, I misunderstood.
Okay,
so
no, no, no. You weren't. I was thinking of how you were saying it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Do you have any questions since you're sitting here?
I don't know.
I'm not an official judge. I'm not begging to ask questions.
So guys, talk to me about your project. I mean, we, and now that it's all over, we're going to give you a rating, and it's, you guys should be pleased. And I, frankly, I think this is a pretty heavy undertaking. Trying to solve a problem somewhat out of air in the beginning. Now, obviously, there's a MagSafe, and there are other people who are kind of trying to solve the problem. So what do you think you learned, not just about this concept, what you learn about the whole design idea? You know, whether next week I might say, hey, guys, design a better way to rake, you know, a product that makes it easier to rake my backyard. What did you learn about the design process? Think on it. You don't have to answer it right away. Just process an idea. What did you learn?
I suppose one thing I did learn is better, it's much better to, instead of immediately trying to jump to a final product, it is much better to take things in steps, develop this portion, and then redevelop it until it's the best you can make it, then move on to the next portion.
Okay. Yeah, so like the first time you did this, we got 25 of this, but what do you think? I think that would help, like, we can narrow it down to, like, what we can't do it for, or what is it that we can't do it for.
How about, I mean, you guys don't go to the same school. How was it working with and collaborating with somebody who you really only see here? Did you guys work in some kind of virtual environment, Google environment? Did you work together on other stuff and other way, in other ways?
Generally, we had enough class time to get everything filled out, to get everything finished in class.
Okay. But you still ran out of time.
Yeah.
You could have used another 2 weeks.
We could have used another 2 weeks to find someone to solder a couple connections.
Okay.
That's about it.
Okay.
Oh, right. To solder, we could have used a couple more weeks to solder connections and order more parts because it takes a week for order forms to go through.
What would your advice to be to next year's students when they start embarking on this project?
We had this question with another assignment recently. My thoughts was to make sure to pick a good project, because you're going to be working at this for months and months, so make something you're not going to get tired or frustrated with.
Yeah, and also a partner, a good partner that, like, knows what they're doing. Like if you don't know, you can share ideas with each other. If you don't know, like, the electrical part, you know, it's like, like for me, I didn't know the Blender program, but I knew the AutoCAD, so we worked hand in hand.
What did you guys both do first semester? What was your, was it digital electronics? Or
we were both in
civil engineering. Okay.
And architecture, mostly architecture.
Okay.
happy with this concept?
Not really.
It doesn't seem like it would be...
No,
I mean,
it's not relatable, a building to a small little thing. It's...
Okay. Yeah, and Nicholas used different programs.
Design process is also much different than the two classes. So.
Have you guys scored yourself in your head? Did you guys use this? Did you guys use this as you were going through the project?
Not as we were going through the project.
But have you thought about it afterward? I think that's always interesting. You know, as you're going through, this is what engineers would kind of how they would score themselves, or if they how they would might like, oh, you find gaps in their understanding. You know, moving forward, because obviously you guys are going to whatever you do. One of the things I would suggest to you, Billy is staying on.
Yeah.
Other than you gotta get my advice. Too bad for him. What are you guys doing next year?
Computer engineering business.
Industrial design stuff. Okay.
As you go into those first projects, look at how you're gonna be scored and try to get, because your assessment rubric is going to really help guide your targets. Okay? Sometimes it's fun to just go in and try to solve the problem. Sometimes with unfettered and just like enjoy the process. But at some point in that process, finding a reference point can be the rubric. Okay? You guys actually were very relevant to the rubric. That's why I asked the question. So you did a nice job with it. But if you accidentally hit the rubric, do it on purpose. Okay? Because that's good for you, all right? Any questions for us? I'm not buying your product. I don't drop my phone.
Okay.
Just kidding.
Happens all the time in our
house. Oh, my kid. My son never drops his phone. In fact, he doesn't need an OtterBox. My daughter is forever replacing screens and
Well, my kids have like an extension cord that goes across the room to charge their phones or their computer that needs to be on the ottoman, and the things over here.
Do you have that in your house too? I've got cords coming over the back of our couch and over this, you know. So, I mean, this actually might save them because I don't pay for this stuff. Interesting. It's an interesting identification of a problem because it's legit. I don't know if you got it yourself. So I don't have anything else, guys. I thought you did a nice job. You know, I tried to stay on the rubric, so like a couple times where a consideration of alternatives. I thought you only had two alternatives with the ball bearings and the magnet. So I had to be relevant to the rubric, but I think the rest of it, you were right at it.
Thanks.
So I guess we can give these to Mr. Lindberg first,
yeah,
and then he'll score them up. But I appreciate it. You know, I've seen portions of, not final product, but I've seen portions of all six of the projects or whatever. Pretty good stuff. So, now you guys can go.
I like the smoke alarm thing, though. Definitely.
Yeah.
That's like my house all
but
over.
Honestly, if we had the expertise to do that, we definitely would have gone with that one. Because
you get
so
like a little
random
remote control thing, it's like, awesome.
But
I'm cooking here.
But don't you think that kind of it clearly defeats
but
the
purpose.
But
I'm in the room. That's when it happens.
No,
you're cooking something and it's, you know, got a little smoky in the oven, goes right to that thing. But I'm right there. Now if I'm like...
Oh, have you never had that? Have
yeah,
you
but
never
then if you asphyxiate right there...
No, it's not that bad. My cooking's not that bad. It's just, it's more heat. The heat's rising, it hits that alarm, and then my husband gets on the stool and he takes the batteries out. Now that's dangerous, because if you forget to put them back in, now you're really cooked.
Oh.
That was totally...
Well done. Nice turn of the phrase. So
work on that idea.
Well, guys, well done.
Thank you.
I don't want to belabor your point. I don't want to make you be on stage for long if you have. Okay, I'll give this to Mr. Lindberg, and we should be pleased as well. Good luck, guys. Thanks.